Can't hear me? All right, now we've got the mic working. So we're going to call the meeting to order. It's 4:05. You might guess we were having some audio difficulty, and we think we've got it fixed now, so we're going to go ahead and move forward. We don't actually need a roll call, do we? Okay. So summary of April 6, 2016 board work session. Any additions, corrections? Director Jones.
I brought this up to Jennifer earlier, but I'm hoping that in the future we can have a slightly more expansive discussion of the meeting, so that if somebody wasn't able to attend the work session, they'd be able to understand what took place. I think the summary in this one is a little too sparse.
Thank you. Any other comments? Yes.
There I am. I wasn't here at the meeting, but I did notice that Director Teal is listed both as being present and participating by phone. And that's probably...
He's magic.
Yeah.
Have you met him?
Yeah, I have.
No, that's a good point. He was via conference. Other comments? Okay. And so we will accept them with those amendments. Public comment, a couple of caveats on the public comment. First of all, no public comment for issues that there has been a prior public hearing. Second of all, if you want to make comments on the MetroVision outcomes, that is agenda item 6, we will have a comment period after the staff presentation. So this is just other public comment than that. Anybody that wants to address Mr. Tour.
Thank you. Will Tour with the Southwest Energy Efficiency Project. And I'll be speaking today to the ballot issues filed by the Colorado Contractors Association. First, we'd like to express our appreciation for CCA's willingness to take on the hard issue of transportation finance and help move this issue forward. Their polling efforts have shown that there's increased voter willingness to consider tax increases for transportation and reinvigorated the statewide dialogue. Unfortunately, however, the specific ballot titles they've drafted, we think, are badly misaligned with the needs of the state as a whole and the metro area in particular. We'd like to urge CCA to withdraw these titles and work with a much broader coalition to develop a 2018 transportation funding measure that improves the quality of life and multimodal transportation across the state. Our needs are inherently multimodal. Just a few years ago, elected officials and civic leaders, many in this room, spent 2 years in Impact 64, arriving at a consensus proposal that new transportation funding was needed and that 33% of the total should be allocated to transit and active transportation, with the rest split between CDOT and local governments by the HUTF formula. Unfortunately, none of the titles that are filed reflect this consensus. They range from zero dedicated funding for transit up to a maximum of only 12%, barely a third of the impact proposal, and none has any dedicated funding for active transportation. This is particularly problematic for the metro area, which has the most multimodal needs and plans of any area of the state. Just completing fast tracks requires on the order of $1.5 billion. The NAMS BRT corridors are about $300 million, Colfax BRT $100 million, and the DRCOG 2040 plan is an $800 million placeholder for the next tier of transit corridors to be defined through the regional BRT plan that'll kick off in 2017. In the last TIP cycle, local governments here applied for $125 million more than was available for bike and pedestrian projects, and the 2040 plan shows an unfunded need for bike and ped of $730 million. For comparison, even if the 12% level was adopted in the CCA titles, this would only generate $390 million in the metro area for transit over the next decade. But if it passes, it'll foreclose any opportunity for a regional tax measure to fill these gaps. It's also problematic because without a much bigger transit share, and more of the transit tends to go to the metro area, the formula generates most of the money from the metro area, but spends much of it in the rest of the state. Metro cities would generate 54% of the revenue, but only be guaranteed 11% back. A more balanced approach is needed. Finally, six of the measures, including the one with the most funding for transit, prohibit any of the CDOT's funds from this from being spent on projects that include managed toll lanes. Since CDOT policy assumes managed lanes in congested areas, and almost every major metro project involves managed lanes, this essentially guarantees that the CDOT share won't go to metro projects. It's also just bad public policy. We know from experience that managed lanes are the only way to keep highways from filling back up with congestion. For all these reasons, we hope that you'll ask CCA to withdraw these measures, but use their energy to work with a broad coalition of stakeholders to develop a balanced measure that addresses the multimodal needs of the entire state, including the metro area. And I have a fact sheet that I'd like to pass around with a little bit more information. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Tour. Anybody else that would like to address the board?
Hi, my name is Karen Moldovan. I'm the policy director at LiveWell Colorado. We're a statewide organization working on access to healthy eating and physical activity. And I would also like to provide comment on the Colorado Contractors Association proposed ballot measures to increase the statewide sales tax for transportation funding. As Mr. Tor said, we are appreciative of the efforts to improve transportation infrastructure in Colorado and for the conversations it has spurred. However, we're acutely aware of significant unmet need to fund active transportation projects. A walkable and bikeable community helps improve the health of residents, leads to a potential reduction in healthcare costs, and improves economic development. As Colorado's population grows, transportation and mobility investments are critical for our economic future and quality of life. Particularly with millennials, they're embracing active transportation and transit. It's a need of our growing demographic. Transportation revenues should include road maintenance and infrastructure, but also must include bicycle and pedestrian infrastructure, as well as funding for transit. Low-income individuals and communities of color are often more dependent upon walking, bicycling, and public transit as their modes of transportation. Despite that fact, low-income communities are critically lacking in bicycle and pedestrian infrastructure. The safety and convenience of walking and biking is vitally important for all Coloradans, but it's especially significant for communities without safe and accessible infrastructure who rely on it to get to work, to school, grocery store, medical appointments. It's important to note that 30% of Americans do not drive, with approximately 20% being older adults and people with disabilities. LiveWell Colorado recently commissioned a poll of 800 Colorado likely voters and found that 74% believe it is extremely or very important to make it safer for children to walk or bike to school. Since today is Bike to School Day, I thought it was fitting to share that in the 2016 state report cards issued by the Safe Routes to School National Partnerships, Colorado lost points, particularly in the category for active transportation funding. The report notes that Colorado does not provide matching funds for high needs communities. CDOT recently awarded Safe Routes to School funding for fiscal year 2016. The grant request detailed nearly $7 million in project costs. CDOT was able to fund $2.5 million. Most communities in Dr. Cog's region have needs regarding pedestrian accessibility issues, widening sidewalks, and addressing gaps in sidewalk inventory. These needs are existent in terms of connectivity with our rail stations. We know that there's a safety issue in terms of not being able to walk and bike safely. We have data around pedestrian deaths, pedestrian injuries that we would like to share in terms of how this is beyond just making our communities pretty or nice, but making sure they're safe. Thank you for the opportunity to provide comment.
Thank you. Anybody else that would like to address the board? Seeing nobody, we will move on to agenda item 5, presentation on transportation funding initiatives. Mr. Morrow.
Thank you. Am I supposed to say thank you, Director?
Whatever.
I answered Mr. Chair and members. So I think we have the first group or person that we have for you to present on, we've got two of these funding initiatives. And the first one we'll ask to come up is Maria Garcia Berry, who's with CRL Associates and the what's being called the Colorado Priorities Campaign, and this is the fiscal reform measure. So, Maria.
Is there a Rich?
You're doing, okay, sorry. Sorry, I want to make sure I understood who was moving the... Are you trying to help? There you go. Okay, thank you. I normally have a loud voice, so. But thank you so much for having us here today. I know we're on a short time frame, so I want to walk you through what Colorado Priorities is all about. I think before you've heard, you've had at times presentations from Build a Better Colorado, BBCO. We're the fiscal effort of that branch that's kind of gone its own separate way in order to become a much more comprehensive and robust campaign, and have basically done a couple of other research beyond what BBCO has done. So I want to go through and tell you what our current fiscal challenge is. Some of you, none of this is news to you guys. You guys are actually the leaders. Robin's laughing in all of this, but the state unfortunately does not always follow the lead of local governments. Maybe they should more often than not, right? So why are we here? As you all know, in 1992, Colorado passed TABOR, the Taxpayer Bill of Rights. I have to tell you that I think the most astonishing thing that we have seen in our vast body of research in the last year and especially in the last 6 months, and most recently in a March focus group, that it took 22 minutes in one focus group for people to even know that we had TABOR. It was a focus group of Republican women in Aurora. And only after it was prompted and they saw it and they called it TABOR. So that's how much knowledge there was. Neither one of the two focus groups, by the way, anybody ever talked about REF-C or whatever happened to REF-C or what REF-C was. So given the fact that the population has grown a lot in the last 10 years, the 24 years since 1992, the voter right now doesn't quite understand why we're doing this. As you know, TABOR caps the amount governments can increase their budget each year by the sum of inflation plus growth. Anything beyond that must be refunded to taxpayers unless we ask permission. Colorado currently cannot retain its revenues, all the revenues that it can retain or collects. And this year we see individual tax rebates between 13 and 41. Obviously, under TABOR, we can ask to retain revenues and asking the voters for permission. Let me show you the chart of how the excess revenues are returned. I don't know if you can see that very well, but as you see that we've got certain years that are above the cap, the legislature was clever and very clever this year so that we are avoiding for next year an ability to do rebates by basically lowering the amount that they're collecting from the hospital provider fee, which there's 7 days to go, so if all of you can inform us as to what's happening, I'd love to know to be able to do that. But clearly, beyond that, if hospital provider fee passes, which is a big deal, we have a different conversation, so we're here to brief you, but you need to understand that if hospital provider fee passes, we may not go forward. And the reason we may not go forward, because hospital provider fee, if it passes and it gets enacted as an enterprise, would give the state of Colorado up to 8 years where they would not be in a rebate situation. As you will see, we have a sunset on our effort and would only give you an additional 2 years. So basically, as you know, most local governments in Colorado have passed similar measures. 50 out of the 64 counties, 271 cities and towns, and 173 to 178 of the school districts of the state of Colorado. The last time the state did this was for only 5 years, which was for FC. And I think that probably in hindsight, if you talk to all the people who still have battle scars from that battle, it probably should have been longer because it did not allow the state to go through multiple dips and falls in terms of the economy. So meanwhile, as we go through this, there are four issues that our research showed that was really very important to Colorado and were Colorado priorities. One is education. So as you can see, the red line is the mandated Amendment 23 line, which is where funding should go. This is, of course, shows where the state can in fact do at this point. And obviously we need more money for education. We're 40th in the nation when it comes to per pupil spending. And I think the other thing that we've learned very clearly in our research, when people talk about education, and actually in one of our focus groups, it was the men's focus group, it became very, very active, which was education is not just K-12, education is preschool, education is vocational education, and education is also higher education. Those were all very important issues that resonated through the voter. It will will come as no surprise to you that transportation, or excuse me, let me just show you this chart. I'm sorry, on higher ed. The higher ed costs, I find this to be a pretty dramatic. I guess I must have, you know, had kids a lot earlier or something. I would have been at the beginning of the shift. But as you can see, the dramatic inverse of what's happened to higher ed cost shifts to students in the state of Colorado over the last of the 15 years. It used to be 68% of all the money was paid for by the state. Now it's 64% of all the money is paid for by the students. That actually resonates really, really loudly when you start talking to voters in a focus group. And we heard that much more at times in some of them than the K through 12 experience. We then have, of course, going to transportation. You all know this better than anybody, but obviously Colorado's population has grown by 56%, vehicle miles traveled has grown by 69%, and the CDOT's budget has gone up by 31%, so there's actually a big disparity. I think that the other thing that we have learned in terms of transportation needs, and you know, when we talk about the voter with transportation, it's all in one big pot. It's congestion, it's growth, it's development, it's all these things. They're not quite sure what the answer is, by the way, other than it's a problem, and it's a problem that needs to be fixed, even though at times people would sit there and say, we're growing and we need to know this, but we need to keep up with our growth in some way. Obviously, $2 billion a year in cost to motorists from driving in roads in need of repairs. 31% of Colorado's major urban highways are congested, and 17% of Colorado's bridges are still structurally deficient or functionally obsolete. So the other pieces that we found in our research is the need and desire to address senior services, given the fact that you're the area agent, that's not coming, not surprise. But obviously Coloradoans are getting older, and that is a significant issue that has come up, and the lack and ability and accessibility to senior services were important. And the final one, what I think was really became important, and this became out of primarily our open-ended in our research, was mental health. People in the state believe, and it was really pretty uniform, that mental health needs are a serious problem in Colorado. Obviously, we were doing our two focus groups that we did in Aurora for a reason. Every single one of them immediately when we started talking about mental health, reference to the fact that we were not far away from the site, as they call it. So 58% of all the people over the last four, since 2010 to through 2014, who have needed mental health services have not been able to get provided mental health services in Colorado. So where does that, where was our path to ballot and what did we do? And this all started, BBC started working for almost 18 months. We built on that coalition. They've done a wealth of research and information and talking throughout the state. We are trying to build a much broader coalition than what BBCO has done, but we have really used a lot of their data points and from very much different parts of the state because it got a lot of robust and participation. We also then conducted extensive research. In December, we did an 800-sample poll. In January, we did another 1,200-sample poll that was done by, under the umbrella of BBCO, but a lot of it was focused on the fiscal issues and determining the priorities. Then we did our own fiscal-only issues. In February of this year, we did an 800-sample, which we split between, and the reason was we wanted to know whether we could have to have a sunset or not have to have a sunset on this issue. And then we did focus groups in March. We were pushing our deadline because, of course, we were trying to preserve all our options to go to the ballot because we had to go to title board setting and we had to finally file a title. So what we learned is that K through 12, jobs in the economy, transportation and roads are the top three issues. We have a lot more data on this as we go through this. And then we finally started deciding what ballot language we tested. And what we did is we asked for a 10-year, for lack of a better word, timeout from Tabor that we could retain excess revenues and that we would have a, what we are calling for right now, guardrails, that we would have a minimum of 35% go through go to education. That would include P20, so it includes the entire gamut of education. That no less than 35% would be spent on transportation, And then any money, and then the legislature could come back, because that's 70% of the money, of the pot. If the legislature decided they could spend more money on transportation and education, they could, of the next 30%. But if they didn't, the only other two issues they could spend money on were mental health services and senior services throughout Colorado. We tried to test open-ended, no programs, no issues as to what we were. That was a non-starter. Unfortunately, if you were listening to our focus groups, there was not a lot of faith and confidence in our General Assembly in terms of being able to do some things right, so they did not feel that they could give them a blank check. When we tested issues without a sunset or with a sunset, you see that there is a literally 2% difference. We were at 60% with a sunset, at 58% without a sunset. We believe that until we got to focus groups, we finally learned what that reason was, because the voter can't tell when you're asking them, reading them a question that doesn't have a sunset, whether it has a sunset or not. When we split sampled the two focus groups. We gave them the exact same language, one without a sunset and one with a sunset. And what we learned is that they couldn't tell that there wasn't a sunset until we prompted them. And the minute they found out that there wasn't a sunset for the state of Colorado to do this in perpetuity, we lost everybody in the focus group. So we filed three titles. I think it's important that you'll understand why our thought process is what we did. So our key findings from research were voters are actually optimistic about the future of Colorado. The right track, wrong track question in our poll was the highest we've seen it since we've been part of coalitions along with Tony, et cetera, over the last 3 years or 4 years as to how people were feeling about the right track, wrong track. We found actually more unanimity in the state now. There's been a lot of drop-off at times between the metropolitan area and outstate as to where they thought the right track, wrong track question was, but people are feeling optimistic about the future of Colorado. We tested a lot of questions about their feeling about their financial security, if they thought they were going to be doing better in a year from now or 2 years from now, or if they're going to be better or worse, and all of it came out pretty positive. I was actually surprised. It's very clear, only 12% of the people of the state of Colorado know anything substantial about Tabor. And so that is one of our biggest challenges. They don't understand. When we in our focus groups, we were talking to them and saying, here's what we're doing, and here's what we have to do it. They'd all sat there for about 15 minutes and asked each other, the focus group itself, why do we have to do this? Why are we trying to do this? We must get out our message first, and our measure does have diverse support. I think that even in our toughest areas, we still had a pretty good support among Republicans. Republican males are not necessarily our best allies. Women are our best allies in this issue as we talk through it, not surprise. And so as we learned from all that research and we did it, we then went ahead and submitted three ballot titles. And so the three are Amendments 116, which is we allocate revenues but without a sunset. 117 is the 10-year sunset and revenues are allocated. And then 118 is there's a 10-year sunset but there's no revenue allocated. We did those for all kinds of reasons. My good friend John Caldera has in fact challenged us every step of the way, and they did ask for a rehearing. Actually, he helped us in helping our title. It was interesting. He wanted to get some things in our title, and it ended up helping our title because we now have our 35% in our title, which we didn't know. One of the problems we have, and I think all of us as being local governments, when you guys refer something, you have more latitude to put something in your title. We tried to put without increasing taxes, and the title board told us that was not appropriate, that was biasing the question, versus a lot of you, when you guys have put things on the ballot that do not require a tax increase, you do say that, and you say that very clearly. The title board said no. John wanted to put in some language in there about how nobody would ever get a rebate for the rest of their life or something like that. And so the title board said, yeah, it's okay. One cancels the other one in that aspect. We are moving forward with ballot initiative 117. I think that what you need to know, we are in front of the court. Briefs are due today, Jake?
Next Wednesday.
Yeah, next Wednesday, I'm sorry. Jake Martin, who's with me when starting the campaign. And we truly have a dilemma in the sense of if hospital provider fee passes, we then have to re-examine what we go forward. So we're being very conservative in our approach. We have gotten petitions approved. We are going to kick off a volunteer petition drive on May 14th around the state because we need to keep moving. I want to make sure that we understand what this measure does not do. We don't raise taxes, so that is correct. We do not amend the Constitution. We do not change any existing formulas. I think what's important, and you'll see in our as I go through the chart, we don't change the formula of the way the school finance is restructured. We don't change the formula of higher education, and we don't change the formula of transportation. All we're doing is trying to make sure that the state can retain these revenues. We are following Tabor, and we are defining spending allocations. So as we go through the next chart, you will see where the 35% that goes to education is preschool, K-12, higher ed, and vocational education. Transportation, increased capacity, mass transit, repair of underpasses, ensure roads and bridges. Basically, it's a very broadly, it's in, you have a one-pager, but we have the initiatives with you, which we can leave behind. And then what we did do is, on the transportation side, not that we don't love the state patrol or ports of entries, but if you follow the HUTF formula to its nth degree, that's who comes off the top first. So we made sure that we bypassed that and that the money went straight, the 60% for CDOT and the 18 and 22% for cities and counties. And that is where we decided to do. We actually have been challenged on single subject. Caldera and Natalie are challenging us based on the fact that they think we violate that because we're allocating revenues. So anything else that we tried to put in this ballot title was probably going to risk us even more. Then on the flexible spending, it can be used for transportation and education additional if the legislature so deems itself. But then all remaining funds may only be used for mental health services and senior services at that end. So with that, I'm more than happy to answer any questions that you've got. We are proceeding as if the legislature's there, but you know, it's kind of in parallel pass. And then if the if hospital provider fee doesn't pass, we will initiate, and after we get through the Supreme Court, we will initiate a paid petition drive. If hospital provider fee passes, then we have to have a different conversation. So I'm more than happy to answer any questions or any thoughts, observations, comments. Hopefully, as we get more certainty as to what's happening in the next 7 days, we'd love to reach out to each one of you in your communities individually, because you guys have done this more at the local government level and the state is following behind. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the presentation, Ms. Garcia-Berry. Director Jones, please.
I was just curious if you had a list of endorsers.
We have some. We have not really gone out there, and we've got some people who are sort of in the wings. Some of our stakeholders who are very much part of this are very much involved in the hospital provider fee fight up at the Capitol. And so everybody's saying we're waiting through. We've got like some co-chairs and vice chairs and an executive committee that we're ready to roll out, but some people have asked us to wait until after the legislative session is over. Our petition drive, though, is being launched, and this is by Greater Ed, Greater Education Colorado, and a combination of the Education Association and some of the members and activists that are involved in the BBCO process. And we're trying to target 14 and 15 cities throughout the state on May 14th.
Got it.
Other questions or comments? Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you.
Mr. Morrow. You know what, I should have mentioned before that the presentations tonight are really for information only. We will be in 2 weeks at the board meeting being asked to take a position as a board on both of these sets of issues, but tonight is for information only and for you to have an opportunity to kind of digest it and ask further questions if you'd like. Mr. Morrow.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So the next presenters on the we'll call them the CCA proposals, I guess. We have Tony Milo, President, CEO, Executive Director of Colorado Contractors Association, and Jeff Coleman, and I don't know what your Move Colorado, that's right. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. My name is Tony Milo. I'm Executive Director of the Colorado Contractors Association, and I apologize for not...
Whoop, you lost your mic for some reason.
Oh, there we go.
There you go.
How's that? My name is Tony Milo, Executive Director of the Colorado Contractors Association. With me is Jeff Coleman, who represents Move Colorado. And although these initiatives have been dubbed the CCA proposals, it actually is a very broad coalition of construction industries across the state, including AGC Colorado, the Construction Industry Coalition of Colorado, Move Colorado, and CCA. And I think it's important to note that CCA represents infrastructure contractors across the state. Our members build not only roads and bridges, but also transit facilities, bike paths, underground utilities, airports, the whole range of public services, public works that are built here in Colorado are built by CCA members. I think a lot of many of you have heard this presentation before. Many of you have read about the initiatives, and I think it would just be really good to take a little bit of time to talk about some of the facts. There's been some misstatements and maybe some misunderstandings about what these initiatives do and don't do, and I think it would be good just to clear up a few of those immediately and talk a little bit about, you know, how we came to where we are. We were very involved and supportive of the Impact 64 process. In fact, we helped fund a majority of the polls that that were used to support the Impact 64 process, and we were supportive of it all along. Unfortunately, the polling at the end of the day, that was about 3 years ago now, didn't support us moving forward with an initiative, and that whole effort was kind of shelved or mothballed. About 10 months ago, we had thought to ourselves, well, you know what? The economy is much better than it was 3 years ago. Gas prices are at an all-time low. Let's just go into the field and test a gas tax increase, thinking that that might be a really easy thing to get done. Results of that came back, and there was less than 30% support statewide for even a 10-cent gas tax increase, which only raises about $300 million. While we were disappointed to see that, there were some things in that survey that were very encouraging. Probably the biggest thing that encouraged us was voters by a large margin, Republicans, Democrats, and Independents, all said transportation, roads, congestion, and safety are the number one issue to them right now. It even outpaced K-12 education funding in the minds of voters by a significant margin. And that was the first time any of us in the industry had seen those kind of numbers ever. So this told us something that we're onto something here. The voters want something done about our transportation system. This issue is ripe to move forward. Also in that same survey, we tested a 1% statewide sales tax increase dedicated to transportation. We were surprised to see at that time that 1% sales tax increase received 50% support from Coloradans across the state. Taking that information, fast forward a few more months, and last July we went out into the field again, and again it was a statewide live survey, 600 likely voters, about a 19-minute survey, and really drilled down into the sales tax to find out, you know, is there a sweet spot that we could find with the voters to get into the mid to high 50s. It ended up about the 0.6% sales tax increase dedicated to transportation flowing into the Highway User Tax Fund did receive about 58% support from voters statewide. And that was really the impetus to the initiatives that we filed. Before we actually wrote the language that we filed, we did a little bit more polling to really test the various ingredients of the initiatives. And I think that, you know, Will had mentioned there are things like tolling prohibitions with the new money, there's sunsets, there's different amounts going to transit. And all of those things are to try to find, again, that sweet spot of where the voters are to get us up into those high 50s, which is the numbers that the experts tell us is where you want to be to move forward with a very expensive campaign. So the reason we filed 10 was to keep our options open as we continue to poll. We're in the field right now. Again, another 600 likely voter statewide poll testing these various components and these initiatives. And I would say that at this point, you know, we don't know if we're going to move forward or not. I mean, the polling is really going to tell us if we should move forward or not. Again, if we're not in the mid to high 50s in our polling by next week, I'm not sure that that our funders would say we should move forward. Couple of things about transit funding, and I've heard from the Metro Mayors, I've heard from from transit advocates, and I'm sure Dr. Cog is interested in transit as well. We're working on some things right now that I think will create a lot more flexibility in the funds, both the statewide, the CDOT funds, and local agency funds. And I would say, and I'm telling every organization, before you take a position on these initiatives, let us get our work done over the next couple of weeks. Let us get our polling done. Let's see where that polling is. Let's see which one of these 10 initiatives actually comes out to be on top. Let's really look at the numbers on what are the dollar increases for each one of your cities and counties, because that money, as you know, is 100% flexible. And I'll give you an example. Under most of our proposals, the city of Denver would go from about $24 million a year to $48 million a year in HUTF funding. That doubles your HUTF funding. That money is totally flexible. You can do whatever you want with it. So I would urge each one of you to take a look at those numbers, take a look at those dollars, and see what you could do in your cities and your counties with that kind of increase in real dollars, which is totally flexible. If the city of Denver decided to build $24 million in bike paths with their new money, that would be great. Our members would build those bike paths. So, you know, there's a lot of rhetoric right now going on about some people like the proposal, some people don't. But again, let's look at the numbers. Let's look at the dollars and see what we can do to work together to improve our transportation systems. Overall, this proposal would bring in about $689 million per year. It would go into the Highway User Tax Fund. CDOT would get 60% of that money. The local agencies would get 40% of that money each year. Our base proposal does include the traditional 10% of CDOT's 60% to statewide transit. There is a lot of talk about what CDOT might be able to do, how flexible CDOT might be able to be in spending this money on things other than just roads and bridges. So I think we need to have a lot more conversation here before we make a rash decision about any of these initiatives. I think we need to look at the dollars and look at what we can really accomplish. And I don't want to see this opportunity go wasted. We know that transportation is at the top of mind with voters. We know this is a good year to go to the ballot for a lot of reasons. There's a lot of reasons it might be a difficult year as well because there is so much on the ballot and it's going to be an expensive election year. But I guess I would urge this group, I appreciate the opportunity to speak to this group, and I would just urge this group to allow us to provide you with the facts and the numbers and allow us to get our homework done over the next couple of weeks before you make your final decision. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Milo. Questions or comments? I started to say Commissioner. Director Kniech.
That's all right. I'm a city and a county. I don't mind that. I should have asked this on the last one, but it applies to both when you're using HUTF. From the portion the state gets, how much, if any, are they required or may they spend on transit?
So the way our proposals are written is CDOT would get 60% of the total money that comes in, and then 10% of CDOT's money would be set aside and required to be used on transit. In most of the proposals, there is one that's 20%, and there are some that are none. But the middle of the road one is the 10% transit set aside.
Right. So I guess if I may, Mr. Chair, I'm asking
Please.
About the portion that's not dedicated for transit. So just and again this refers to the debruising proposal as well. So the standard HUTF dollars that go to CDOT, may they use them on transit? Is there a cap? Is there a floor? So not those that are designated for transit,
right,
but just those that go to
right.
CDOT with HUTF.
Right. That's an excellent question. Thank you for that. And that's the conversation that we're having right now is we're delving into CDOT's budget to see how much flexibility they have with federal funds and other types of monies that they receive. They have some flexibility. And we're trying to see right now how many dollars are really there and available and are flexible on CDOT's side and how they might be able to spend that on things other than roads and bridges. So that's the homework we're hoping to do over the next couple of weeks. And one more comment I wanted to make about the toll road language that is in a couple of our provisions. With all respect to Will, what he said about not being able to use this money in the Denver metro area is just not correct. The language states that this new money shall not be used to build toll lanes. It doesn't mean that CDOT can't use their existing money to build toll lanes. It doesn't mean they can't continue to use P3 private dollars to build toll lanes. It's just saying that if the voters approve a 0.6% sales tax increase to improve the transportation system, we're not going to use your tax dollars to build toll lanes. And that's what the intent of that language is. It not in any way prohibits the continuation of building toll lanes in Colorado.
Director Strzok.
This is, are we supposed to vote on this at the next meeting?
I was going to comment on that to Mr. Milo. I know you're talking about, you know, having your homework done and the next couple weeks and whatever. This is scheduled to be on the agenda 2 weeks from tonight for a vote, a position vote. So, yes.
And I guess I would ask if that's enough time to do the homework, and then if it isn't, if there's a reason to move forward at this point or not. To delay.
If I may, Mr. Please. Chairman, I would say I'm going to try as hard as I can to get our homework done in the next 2 weeks, but I would also say that I don't know that there's any urgent need for this group to take a position in 2 weeks. We've got a lot of time between now and November. There's a lot of work that is yet to be done, and I would say that in order for us to really get the facts to this group before they make a decision would be the most important thing. And if it took a little bit longer, maybe it slid to the next month. I can't see the harm, in my opinion, of doing that. I think the most important thing is that we get all the facts to you all before you make your decision.
And that's certainly a decision that the board as a whole can make if we want to adjust an agenda. I think that I've heard some people express that they would like to make the decision sooner rather than later. So that might be part of the conversation. Other questions or comments? Director Jones.
Thank you. I'm curious, has CDOT ever spent more state money on transit than it was mandated to? I've never seen that happen that I'm aware of.
No, and probably to respond to Director Nietzsche's, the way the HUTF law is written today, CDOT can't spend HUTF dollars on transit. So when they first were able to start spending money on transit was with the initiation of House Bill 1310. That was the first bill that actually obligated and directed CDOT to spend money on transit. So then at that point in time, they began spending 10% of their dollars on transit for their strategic project corridors. And that has persisted to continue on through the projects they're doing now. But new funding, the way we've written it up, will then allow that flexibility to go to transit programs. If that answers your question, Director Jones.
Sort of.
What part does it not answer?
We'll see. I'll be interested in seeing the your homework that comes up with a different configuration for how CDOT has spent its money than it has in the past.
Correct.
But for those of us from corridors that are relying on transit revenues to enhance or transportation funding to enhance transit, we want to make sure that we have the utmost flexibility on both CDOT and local side to spend that money on the transportation improvements that work best for our corridors. So,
understood. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll just comment on that. I mean, we hear you loud and clear, and we're going to do everything we can to build in as much flexibility as possible. I look forward to coming back with that information. The local share here, I think, is something that we don't want to miss. I mean, most cities are going to receive over 100% more every year in their highway user. I'm sorry?
And counties.
And counties. Counties are going to be, I think, it's about an 80% increase in their HUTF for counties. And that's real dollars. And that's dollars that that you all can build with what you want with that money.
Other questions or comments? Director Millay.
Just to that point, though, I mean, depending on the community that you're in, that sounds wonderful, but there are donor communities and there are communities that actually do benefit from this. And I think, unfortunately, my community ends up being a donor community on the way that we get much more money back from the HUTF money, but we don't get much from that anyway. So I do think we need to keep that in mind and our ability to control the dollars that while CDOT certainly could be spending them, and you're going to get back to us on the flexibility of that, we have very little control then. That's still CDOT's money. It's not money that's coming in. And I think the mobility issue is something that in the metro area is extremely important to all of us. So I appreciate your perspective, but I think it's up to each individual community to do the homework to see really how these dollars would flow back to you and how much control you would have over them.
Right, right, and that's what that's the homework that we're trying to do is so you will see the actual dollars that you will actually have control of in Lone Tree. Yeah.
Could I?
Just Director Jones.
I apologize. One more question. We've heard numbers tonight on the regional contribution in terms of sales tax versus the regional benefit that we're getting, and I believe the numbers were on the order of the region will be paying out 54%. I think at least the cities would be in generating these funds, but only receiving somewhere in the neighborhood of 11% of the benefit. We are the metro region. What do you say about those numbers and why that should appeal to us?
Well, those same numbers apply to the Impact 64 proposal. It was a 7/10 of a sales tax increase, and I think the same math would show an even worse return on investment because it's a higher sales tax increase. Sure.
Yeah, I guess my question is, I don't know where that 11% is coming from. As you know, we have not developed a list or any indication of how the money has been distributed. So there is no distribution that's already been determined. Rather, what we would like to do is work with CDOT and use their distribution, which in this case, right now, and Director Schaffel, what Dr. Cog gets 40% of CDOT revenues roughly right now. So we would anticipate that that percentage would be very much analogous to that. The reason we didn't create a list is because we didn't feel we had the fortitude to do that. You, Dr. Cog, and the other 14 planning regions in the state know how the money should be best spent in your community. So we weren't going to feel so bold to come out with our own list. There's lots of lists. You have a list right now in Metro Vision that shows if you had revenue where you would spend it. So we would want to work with you, or you, with CDOT, to figure out how to spend the Dr. Cog allocation the best way Dr. Cog would see how to spend theirs, and similarly work with the other 14 transportation planning regions to spend their allocations in the manner that best suits and meets the needs of their communities and their transportation needs in their region. So there is no 11%. I don't know where that number comes from. And I don't know where you're getting 54. I assume that's from the state, but we haven't devised any list to say that there's 10% or 11% or 50% going to Dr. Cog.
Director Jones.
Last question or comment. The Impact 64 proposal took 33% off the top for transit, which we know disproportionately would flow to the metro region given where transit is being, where transit projects are going in. And so I guess I would correct your assessment of whether or not the money would flow the same from the Impact 64 as it's going from your proposal for that reason.
I'll stop.
Director Kanich.
Thanks. I just wanted to just share some math. So first of all, I think the slides are a little misleading because they say things like 20% to transit, but it's only 20% of the state share. It's not 20% of the total. The actual is more like 11%. And because I just wanted to check and make sure we're all doing the same math. But if you got a guarantee that 10% of every dollar going to CDOT on the road bridges side was going to transit, then the biggest percentage you end up with is 16% of total. So I just want to share with folks how the math of the total amount, of the total every dollar spent. So I think it matters a lot. You go from 11% of the total to 16% of the total if there's 10% also taken off of the $330 million. So I guess I just want to share that that's the best case scenario we're talking about here. I don't see a scenario that gets to 20%.
That presumes that no local share would go to transit. So, yeah, if all the local share did not go to transit, then that math right. would be absolutely correct. But if local governments such as Denver, or other communities wanted to put a portion or all of their money into transit, then that number could obviously grow quite rapidly. And it allows the choice to be made by the communities that they serve. So if I look at Kiowa County, they probably don't need to invest much of their money in transit. They probably want to work on just keeping roads maintained, whereas in Denver, you may want to invest your money. It allows you, the local governments, the flexibility to make those decisions with your money.
Can I just clarify really quickly, though? There's a star on my slide that says up to 15% of county municipal funds can be used for transit and other multimodal. It doesn't say the entire amount could be. Does the HUTF formula put a cap? Because you just said we could use every dollar on transit if we wanted.
Right, and I apologize. That was an older slide, but we since got clarification that the 15% limit is for transit operating costs. So there is a 15% limit on transit operating costs, but there is not a limit at the local level on capital construction for transit facilities.
Thank you. And I guess the only other thing I will add to just close out my comments and questions is that I don't know of many transit lines that are solely contained within one jurisdiction. So it doesn't help us much to have the funding coming to local governments. And, you know, I cannot build half of a rail line, you know, to head to Arvada. I need Arvada, you know, so that's why having transit funds flow through a state entity makes a lot more sense than trying to ask multiple jurisdictions to try to line up funding for a bus line that crosses. I mean, in this area, we have very little transit that's solely contained within a jurisdiction. It's mostly last mile stuff. You know, that's the only stuff that's wholly contained within a jurisdiction. So your answer that we could just make up for it on the local side doesn't operationally work very well for systems that are multi-jurisdictional. So, thanks.
Well, Arvad is at the table. You can talk to him. No.
Can I build a rail line to your house?
Other questions or comments? Seeing none, I would thank you for your presentation and for your time. And ask Director Kneach, did you want to have Colorado Priorities speak to your other question? Okay.
I guess email me if the answer was wrong, that, you know, you seem to think you don't know yet whether there's a cap or a floor on transit from the CDOT stuff, and so if they disagree, they can just send us.
I was referring to the previous presentation that I thought you had a question for that. Okay, thank you. Okay. All right. Thank you very much for both of the presentations and the conversation. And we will move on to agenda item 6, Metro Vision Outcomes, which is under attachment C.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So we will transition to the wordsmithing portion of the agenda. So I'm not much of a staff presentation, mostly a recap from last time, just so that everybody's kind of up to speed. As you recall, back in April, you spent some time working through a series of draft regional objective narratives for the draft Metro Vision plan, and you actually made quite a bit of progress and got through about half of them. And so really, this agenda item is about picking up that conversation where you left off, which is regional objective 8, yes. Which all the ones that you'll be talking, this sort of have this up on screen, but this is what you'll be talking about. So we will presumably sort of work in sequence, regional objective 8 through, I believe there are 14 regional objectives. And so that's really your charge for the afternoon. When you begin your conversation and I'm tracking changes, I'm actually going to transition to a different document just that gives me more space so you can kind of see what's happening. But again, sort of the task in front of you is to take these regional objective narratives that are starred as new in your packet, starting with regional objective 8 all the way through the end of the document. So that's what we're asking you to do this afternoon.
So I will put out there that we are an hour into a two-hour meeting, and the goal is for us at starting at regional objective 8 that we would really like to get through this evening so that we can move it forward. I'm certainly not discouraging any conversation or debate or whatever, but just put that out there that we would really like to get through it. So I'm going to do this the same way that I did before. I'm not going to read the regional objective. I'm going to presume that either you read it already or you're a speed reader and you're going to do it right now. And I'm just going to ask the question for regional objective 8 narrative, Is there anything that somebody would like to bring up, questions or comments? Director Montoya.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. In Thornton, we have an issue with supporting this. The wording can limit the ability for Thornton to grow, and so I would like to suggest a substitute wording of encouraging agricultural production and farm to market opportunities within the region where viable, benefits local producers and consumers by saving energy resources, and improves food security for the metro area. The transportation system through its freight network can provide farm to market opportunities to outside the region. So I would suggest that substitute wording.
That's a lot to type. You want to bring it to me? Can you do that? Let's do that.
I can bring it to you.
All right, cool.
Director Jones.
I kind of like the current wording, and I guess I would need clarification from you as to why you think it's limiting to your community. Not quite there.
And there's a question to you after this, in case you didn't catch that.
I didn't catch your question.
Okay.
So we're going to ask Director Montoya to multitask while he's walking back to his chair. So the question is from Director Jones.
I was saying that I kind of like the staff language, and I was curious what about the staff language causes you concern, because I don't – you said something that would be constraining on you, and I didn't understand where that would be or how that would be.
Let me let me talk to Kent here for just a moment, if you don't mind. Well, I think our biggest concern is the word protection. Instead of protection, we're hoping for the word of encouraging. I think that gives us a little bit more flexibility.
Encouraging protection?
You know, I just think, I don't know.
Could you clarify encouraging what? Is it?
Well, let me read it to you again what staff is suggesting to us. And I'm sorry, I'm filling in for our usual member, which is Adam Mikowski. What staff is suggesting is, and I'm going to email this to the gentleman up there, but is encouraging agriculture production and farm to market opportunities within the region where viable benefits local producers and consumers by saving energy resources and improves food security for the metro area. The transportation system through its freight network can provide farm to market opportunities to outside the region.
Director Stolzman.
Thank you. So I'm comfortable with the existing language because of the words where viable. So I think each community has the ability to do what's viable for their community. So I feel like there is a lot of flexibility here, and we still are saying that in general the region benefits from agriculture.
Director Teal.
Actually, I'd like to speak in favor of the proposed modification. I mean, I'm very much in the same situation in Castle Rock. We have a very large cow pasture that is right in the geographic center of our town that, you know, we do have a landowner that does want to develop it. So, I mean, where it is right now, protection of existing agricultural land, yeah, that is restricting. And I get where viable, you know, I mean, I'm with you, Ashley. I get that. What is where viable? What does that mean? Again, that's one of these little jiggly-wiggly little words that it can be interpreted very harshly. It can be interpreted very liberally. So, no, I actually would like to speak in favor of the modification. I think that's a great idea.
Director Brockett.
I thought Director Stolzman's comments were right on. I think the existing language is something I would prefer. The key, I think, is that there's not a verb in this first sentence that's saying you must protect all agricultural land. It's a value statement saying protection of land benefits local producers, saves energy resources, and offers food security. And I think that statement is a true statement. It's not saying you can't convert any agricultural land within the area, but just saying that it provides some benefits. And I think it does provide some benefits. So I'd like to support the existing language.
Okay, well, we don't vote here. We kind of look around and see, you know, where things are lying, and it looks at the moment like it's pretty even. Director Partridge.
I certainly think that word protection creates a lot of question, because how do you protect? There's a lot of ways to protect it. I think it comes out that it's pretty strong language. So again, that's a very strong action word. So I would suggest that we at least consider changing that word protection. And I like that word to encourage. And we've done this quite a few other areas to take away that will, that shall. And I think that word protection is another one of those very strong words that encourage would certainly be a much better word.
All right, we have a cue working here. The first one I have is Director Jefferson. He's on the phone here because we didn't have. Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me. Okay. He didn't have a question. I was just being told who was on the phone. So next I have Director Millay.
You can actually make this change. And I actually do see this more as a statement than a requirement. But if it just said agricultural land and taking out protection of existing, agricultural land and the ability to bring additional land or operations into production where viable benefits local producers. I think we could take out that whole part that seems to be creating an issue, and we still have the same value statement, and I would suggest that might be a nice compromise.
Director Graves.
He needs a mic. Get the man a mic.
Thank you very much. Actually, I concur with Director Millay. I was going to suggest something similar. I think that we can strike that and soften the language. Thank you.
Director Dyack.
Can we invite Director Montoya's staff to come up and just provide some kind of input? I just don't want to lose his thought and perspective. And
I'd be more than happy to do that. Yes, please. If you would identify yourself and kind of give a perspective on this.
Kent Warman, City of Thornton. The word protection is the key to us, is that it's too strong and that it needs to be softened. I think we could live with what Director Millay had suggested and do that. So,
Director Jones.
I guess I just want a little reality check again before we dive into this. This isn't a document that is binding on us. It's aspirational. It's our regional. This sentence says, hey, it's good when you protect farmland. It's good for producers. It's good for the local economy. It's a value statement. There's nothing that requires any action in this. And we can wordsmith to reduce any concern, but I want to just have us take a pause and realize that this, as written, doesn't require anything to be done. And if we continue to look at this document as if each action verb is mandating us to do action, we're not going to get anywhere. B, that's not what this document does. So I just want us to, I don't know, I think we're being a little bit more nervous about wordsmithing than we need to be. So,
Director Dozel.
Is it an objective or a statement? And if it's an objective, then you have some kind of action associated with it. And so by taking out protection of existing and just saying agricultural land, then you're saying a statement. But then the supporting objective 8.1 says conserve significant agricultural lands. So I think that I have a problem with protection too, just by itself. You could even throw encourage protection in the front of it and would solve that somewhat. But is it an objective or is it a statement?
It's the narrative. The narrative.
It says the regional objective 8, and so it's outcome 8, right?
No, what we're talking about the narrative. The objective is...
I know, but it's you've got outcome 8 on the left-hand side, and then you have regional objective 8 narrative. So it is it an objective or an outcome?
All right, so the regional objective 8 is support continued agricultural capacity in the region, right above it. And then we're talking about the narrative.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
So yeah. This is just the descriptor of it. It's the narrative descriptor
and
of
the objective. And we've already approved the objectives.
But the objectives are actionable. So if we take out any action words in... I have a problem with protection without defining it a little bit better.
Director Teal.
Well, I like the original modification. I really like Jackie's modification.
Director Millay.
Wow.
Mayor Director Commissioner Millay.
I like completely stand corrected. I really love Director Millay's.
That's even better.
I like it. I think it's. I think we have some understanding those that still object, still prefer the original language. Completely understand where you're coming from, but I do think that's a great little compromise. I think it still preserves a great deal of the original intent. So, I think I'd like to speak in favor of Jackie's. Excuse me. Director Millay's modification.
Director Stolzman.
Thank you. I think that there's general consensus at this point to move this onto the board for consideration. I think that Director Millay's done a nice job offering a compromise.
I love it. She's my favorite.
that was going to be my next point, so I appreciate that, Director Stolzman. I think that we had... two sides of the conversation, but we kind of met in the middle, and if without objection, we're going to move this forward as amended. Is everybody good with that? And we're on to Regional Objective 9A narrative. Once again, if you would let me know if you have changes, modifications, concerns. I'm seeing nobody jump up and down, so I'm going to say that there is reasonable agreement to move it forward as is. Whew, we're moving now. All right, next we have a Regional Objective 9B narrative. Questions, comments, Director, Mayor?
Yeah, whatever my name
Commissioner
is.
Commissioner Millay.
I just want to clarify, have we reviewed the order of reviewing the new additional supporting objectives recommended by staff? Has this body looked at those yet, or are we going to be doing those after? What's the process?
That happened last month is my recollection.
Okay, so they're not. So these were recommended by staff. In my document, it says new additional supporting objectives recommended by staff, but we've... But that is...
Something that was discussed last month.
So okay, probably, thank you.
Yep, sure.
I just was... wondering if anything had been changed.
Questions or comments on 9B? Seeing none, we will move that forward as well. Excuse me, Director Partridge. God, we were right there.
I was reading.
And then he pulled me back in.
Just have a question regarding same to last line. I may ask communities that were certainly affected by the flooding or any other disaster, the statement rebuild to pre-disaster conditions. Just wondering, is that always feasible? Just a question, maybe those that have been impacted. Because not always is pre-disaster conditions advisable.
Everybody looks at Director Jones immediately.
Mm-hmm. Well, it is a good point, and not always, depending on if the structure is in a hazardous spot, often we wouldn't. So what we could do, and I think it's a good catch, is to add the clause where appropriate or when appropriate.
when appropriate prior to rebuild.
After, what? No?
My concern would be with that you're setting yourself up then for a, what does that mean? I mean, when appropriate, who's deciding if it's appropriate? Is it up to the local?
Hopefully the local governments are.
Well, the people that live in that local government who may want their house back in the flood against the riverbed may disagree with that interpretation is all I'm thinking about.
Director Stolzman.
Thank you. I'm definitely not a linguist, so I could be misunderstanding this, certainly, but the way I understood this, because of the semicolon in that sentence, that impacted communities are supposed to reestablish key elements of the economic, social, and cultural fabric and rebuild those to pre-disaster conditions. So if that's not the way it's meant to be read, I would change the word to those, rebuild those to pre-disaster conditions.
Director Teal.
Yeah, actually, I think that was a good pickup, Ashley.
I'm sorry, say it again.
I thought that was a good pickup. I speak in favor of her her modification.
Of,
you know, the
Director Stolzman?
Director Stolzman, okay. Correct.
Director Dozel.
This is an element of what you will be doing it, as I read it, after a disaster. And rebuilding to pre-disaster conditions, or more optimal, somehow you have to say, because, you know, I think about Superior and Louisville. We had a lot of damage from the flooding. And we actually bought land from residents to take them out of the floodplain. We, in the town of Superior, we went and worked with urban drainage, and we modified the drainage, the path of the Coal Creek itself. We did a lot of changes that are not anything near. We changed our Second Avenue Bridge. We rebuilt it so it wouldn't overflow and flood all the residences around it. So we didn't rebuild to pre-disaster conditions at all. We built to optimize what we learned from the disaster and to make it better. So I think I'd just take that out and leave, we'll reestablish key elements of communities, economic and social, and rebuild better, you know, in the future.
So I'll go to Director Pfeiffer, and then I'm going to make a comment. Director Pfeiffer.
Yeah, I don't think it means the physical environment, because it's talking about economic, social, and cultural fabric. So, and plus, I think that gets addressed if you were to expand that statement where it says become more resilient at the end. So I'm not sure this would be the place for physical change to your environment to make it safer, because it's really focused around economic, social, and cultural fabric.
Director Pfeiffer looked at my notes, because that's what I was going to say. I think my impression is, and I would support both what Director Pfeiffer and Director Stolzman said, because I think if you take the statement as a whole, it is talking about rebuilding to pre-disaster conditions for the things that Director Pfeiffer said, and make improvements to become more resilient. So I think if you take the sentence as a whole, it makes more sense. It's not saying that you're going to, the road is washed away and you're going to come in and bring in infill to make it look exactly like it did before. That's certainly not possible in a lot of cases, but it's to make it more resilient, lessons learned, and do it all for the benefit of the community. Director Beacom.
The like one item that I think the word rebuild is part of the problem. What about reestablish or something along that line? Because you're actually trying to bring back the fabric, not necessarily build something. So maybe reestablish would be a better modification.
Director Jones.
I was going to speak in favor of Director Stolzman's edits. After rereading it with careful scrutiny of the semicolons, I think you're right that was the intention. And if you add those key elements, it clarifies that, because I think Director Partridge raised a good point that, and as did Director Dozal, about we're not rebuilding in every single instance, and certainly not the same way but rebuilding those key elements does make sense. So I think that's the simplest way to clarify that.
I would like to get a sense for traction on changing rebuild to reestablish. I'm seeing a couple of heads go up and down. Okay. So are we comfortable moving this forward as amended, and does staff understand the amendments?
I think so. Someone give me a thumbs down if I've got it wrong.
Director Brockett.
That wasn't an option.
I can't read that tiny. Oh, you good? Okay. All right. It looks to me like we're good with the amended version. We're going to move forward to Regional Objective 10 narrative. Questions, comments, concerns? Going once. Seeing none, we are going to move it forward as is. Regional Objective 11 narrative. Director Montoya.
All right, sorry to be the difficult new guy here. On this one, I'm wondering if, this is just another suggestion, if we can remove the words into centers. The issue we have is most of Thornton's healthcare providers and facilities are not in urban centers, but most of them do have sidewalks and trails going to them. And RTD is currently still expanding in Thornton, so transit's available to some, but not to all providers. So I'm just wondering if we could remove the words into centers.
Conversation on that. Director Graves.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to echo the earlier sentiment of Director Jones to say again, this is an aspirational document. And so I think that all of us, especially in consulting with our staff, sort of wrangle with what it means today, but really this is a future vision for the region. And so I don't think it would be binding and doesn't really reflect current service.
Director Stolzman.
I'd like to speak for it as it's written by staff, because I think it's important that we remember part of this is trying to leverage existing investments. And I think that was part of the thought behind putting some emphasis on putting healthcare facilities in centers, so that we're not putting transit in and not being conscious about where we're putting healthcare in the future.
Other comments on this particular issue? Director Jones.
I agree with Director Graves and Stolzman in supporting the staff proposal.
I'm seeing a lot of heads around the table nodding of supporting the staff proposal. Director Graves.
Just one word of encouragement for Director Montoya. I think it's important for us to all voice, you know, these concerns or things. So never feel that you have to apologize here, because we recognize that you serve a constituency that has an important voice. So we welcome that feedback. Just a thought.
Very, very well said. Director Montoya.
Director Graves, I thank you for those words. And with what you just said before, previously, makes me feel more comfortable with moving forward with the language here. Thank you.
Great. So without objection, further objection, we're going to move it forward as is. Thank you. And we are on to Regional Objective 12 narrative. Comments, questions, concerns? Director Jones was just reaching for her glasses. I thought her hand was going up. I see nobody jumping up and down, so I'm going to say that we're moving 12 narrative forward as is. Regional Objective 13 narrative. Questions, comments, or concerns? Once again, Director Conklin.
Just an observation that the previous references have just been to the region, and the next couple have the Denver region, and I wasn't sure if there was a reason that we had shifted to being specific there.
I don't think there is a specific reason, but that's a good catch, and I think we probably should be consistent. My gut level is that, you know, it is typically called the Denver region. Other comments on that around the table? It's all on Robin's shoulders. That's a good catch, and I think that if staff could make that consistent, that would be great. Other comments on 13? Director Graves.
While we're talking, I think just to say Denver Metro Region always feels, at least to me, much more inclusive if we're going to make consistent language throughout. Denver Metro Region is my suggestion.
I think that makes sense. Director Jones.
I was just curious on the last sentence of that, why we weren't also talking about concentrating housing in centers accessible via transit as well as employment.
I would ask staff, is housing addressed in another narrative?
Most likely the one right before it, but I'll have to catch up with it.
Bob.
And there it does say housing inter near.
The last sentence talks about
inter near major employment centers. Does that work, Director Jones?
It does. I was just curious why we're changing, because the outcome for 13 is all residents have access to a range of transportation, employment, commerce, housing. So.
Gotcha.
It just seemed it would be more consistent with the outcome, because this is about opportunity, which I think includes all of the categories. It seemed like it would be appropriate to say employment and housing.
So is your suggestion to add housing after employment, possibly?
Or you can put it in front. I don't care.
Regions.
Yes.
Housing and employment in centers accessible via transit. Director Atchison.
If I might ask a clarifying question, Mr. Graves. Since we have counties and municipalities that are not considered the Denver metro area, would you entertain not putting Denver metro in there? Because a region is one thing, but when we classify that, we have to think about people like Nederland and some of our outlying counties that are a part of DRCOG, but they are not considered Denver metro.
I'm very flexible. Whatever the will of the body is here, I just want to make sure that whatever the consistent language is that we're using is truly reflective of the broad coalition represented here.
That's my point.
So let's, real quick, I'd like to complete this conversation before we go back to that. So the suggestion is to add housing with employment in the centers of accessible via transit. People around the table good with that? Director Millay.
I guess I'm concerned, but the language just doesn't feel right to me. Local and regional initiatives will continue to leverage investment in transit, but concentrating a significant portion of the region's new employment and housing. I mean, is it new employment and housing that's coming in? We can't retroactively go back.
Director Jones.
I think that's right, unless you're building a new line somewhere, I think, right? That I think it's sort of de facto has to be the new.
There should be some parallels with the one preceding that talked about, the supply and range of housing options, including attainable and accessible units in or near major employment centers will increase. I mean, that is the objective, right? We want to increase. So to me, I would like to keep the language parallel, and I think this language in 13, I don't know what a significant portion is. I like the idea of just saying increase. So I don't have the whole sentence worked out, but to increase the region's employment and housing in centers accessible via transit. I think that language is consistent with the document.
Director Partridge.
I have a question. I know I'm going to go back to outcome 13 as a total. We just use the word transportation. We don't talk about multimodal. So I just have a question. When we talk about a range of transportation, does that include all modes of mobility? That's my first question.
Including jetpacks.
Yes, including jetpacks. Thank you, Director Shinnan.
No, jetpacks versus and drones.
So, Brad, just maybe you can address that. Did you remember, is that all modes of transportation of mobility?
I sort of my eyes went down to 14 for some reason, so I'll have to catch up here for a second. Because like in 14, one of the things that it does talk about the entire multimodal transportation system, but 13, you know, the language that's in front of you is emphasizing the role of transit and connecting people of all ages, incomes, and abilities to job opportunities. That's one of the things that's coming out of that. But obviously, you see reliable transportation connections in the first part. That's all transportation, right? So there's the first piece that's all transportation, and then with a particular emphasis on transit connectivity.
So I would ask Director Partridge, does the fact that that language is in 14 satisfy your need for 13?
Can you give me a minute?
Sure. Yeah. Director Kanich.
Yeah, I think that it's always best to have, I think, a clear stretch goal, you know, if you're being aspirational, and I think, increasing it slightly will not get to the scenario. So I go back to the scenarios we did. And the scenarios show that you have to put a lot of the housing and a lot of the jobs in the urban centers to get the outcomes, not just slightly more. And so I think the word significant here is about getting to the actual outcomes. The efficiency that this sentence itself is talking about, right, leveraging investments, is only achieved if you get to a critical mass. So I would like to keep us with the same language, you know, significant portion of the region's housing and employment, because I think, again, this goes back to all the way back, rewind, to the scenarios we did. And the scenarios required a critical mass. So that's what I suggest that we stick with.
Director Millay.
And I think I'm comfortable with that as long as we put new. And I actually think concentrating, the word, just keeping the word concentrating. So the initiatives will continue to leverage investments in transit by concentrating new employment and housing in centers accessible via transit.
That's fine with me. I'm fine with that.
So we're comfortable dropping the word significant? Is that what I'm hearing?
Well, if you're concentrating it, you're focusing it in. And I agree.
It gets at some of the emphasis of the critical mass. I feel like it covers it.
So there are two directors that are comfortable with that. I see some other heads nodding.
Yep.
Thumbs up.
Can I just confirm with Director Millay, I got it, the way that you knew is replacing about five words. Is that how you meant it?
Very good. We will move it forward. Director Atchison has left. Adams County has an occasion tonight up in Arvada, but I wanted to revisit his concern about the Denver Metro region, that statement excluding some of our partners that are not in the Denver Metro area. Executive Director Shuffle.
Well, yeah, I would like to speak to that because that's how we talk about the region all the time. When we talk about the Denver metropolitan region, we mean Denver, Douglas County, Nederland, Lyons, Larkspur. We mean all of our member organizations. Now, that doesn't mean that the general public necessarily knows who that is, but without naming all those names, I'm not sure how the general public would know. But it's very common for us to refer to the area that Dr. Cog serves as the Denver metropolitan region. Just thought I'd throw that out there.
And I guess I would add that is what our name is as well. Director Kanich.
Thanks. I think on the whole, fewer words in this document can only help. So region instead of any of that is fine with me. And I think also I want to make the radical suggestion that we must delegate some things to staff. We just cannot, they're going to have to copy edit this thing for grammatical errors. They're going to have to check for consistency of words. And we have to be, if we cannot at this point in this process trust our staff to do some of that, we will all likely go insane sitting in this room. So I think that it's okay to punt on it and let you guys you know, you're going to have a preamble. It's going to say when we say region, and you're going to, you know, I'm okay with delegating.
That's one of the attorneys in the room suggesting fewer words.
You often have to pay by the word, you know, so it's.
So I'm hearing several things, and I guess I kind of like to get a sense of the room. My personal perspective is Denver Regional Council of Governments is who we're known as, and so it has it right in the title of who we are. And I understand that, you know, people like Georgetown may not be in the metro region, but that is the name of our organization. Are people generally comfortable moving it forward as Denver Metro Region, or do we want to just leave it as region? Director Jones.
Well, I was going to say, I think it is important to embrace the fact that we are the Denver Metro Region somewhere in the front, define that, and then I agree with Robin.
Allow.
Fewer words, region then kicks back to Denver Metro Region. We don't have to use those words elsewhere in the document.
Works for me. Everybody reasonably okay with that? I see a lot of thumbs up. Very good. Got that, Mr. Calvert? All righty. So we are on to regional objective number 14 narrative.
Mr. Chair.
Director Partridge.
You forgot about me.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, I wanted to look at 14 and come back to 13.
Correct. Yep. Go ahead, please.
When I read that whole last sentence, I have concerns, certainly, because when we have two communities in our county, Parker and Castle Rock, did not have transit. You know, I'm just trying to read through this and have some concerns on that. What I just want to assure that just because Parker and Castle Rock may not leverage their investments in transit does not mean that they cannot leverage any other multimodal transportation to employment centers.
I mean 13 or 14?
13. That last sentence. I just wanted to verify that we're okay with that, because certainly we have two major town cities that do not have transit. So that's my concern. I don't want to read into it, but what I read at is it does not limit Castle Rock and Parker to put emphasis on an employment center that doesn't have transit.
Director Knietsch.
I would completely agree. It does not limit. And in fact, I think one of the good things about this document is we actually kind of did this language both ways. So if you look down at 13.3, we actually also want to increase transportation to the places that Castle Rock or others have employment and housing but don't yet have transit. So I think that when we first had this conversation at one of the higher levels, we talked a lot about it's about both directions. It's about bringing the housing and employment to the transit, and it's about bringing the transit, you know, so hopefully someday we can grow those investments. So I agree, it does not limit it.
Okay, great.
Does that help, Director Partridge?
Yes.
Okay, so moving on to regional objective 14 narrative, questions, comments, concerns. I don't see anybody jumping up and down, so I'm going to say that we can move this forward as staff suggests, and we got through all of them. That's not the end of the agenda, but we got through all of them. Yes.
And just, Mr. Chair, real quick, I'll just mention it's noted in the memo, but you obviously have done a lot of work so far, and the March draft of last year that's online doesn't reflect a lot of that. So one of the things, we feel like this is a good time to now revisit, repackage, and see kind of what that draft lays out with all the hard work that you put in over the past few months or year on this. And so that's one of the things that we're going to do is to, you've done a lot, but now how does it sort of reassemble and come back together in terms of an overall document? So that's one of the things that we will pick up now that you've made it through this milestone.
Director Millay.
The other thing, just to pick up on Robin's comments, I want to give staff full editorial privilege to change. Some of this is repetitive and wordsmithing, and so as long as content is not being changed, I don't expect this to look exactly like it looks today, because we use the word region three times in one sentence. So please do that. I think it's a difficult document to read if you don't make those changes. So I expect to see it look a little bit different.
We appreciate that. That's one of the reasons we wanted to revisit it, is to make sure it's still a legible thing that makes sense on the whole, as well as the individual pieces. So that's one of the things that we'll pick up for another conversation.
And of course, we'll want a readability score on it too.
Yes.
I did notice.
I'll set her for a three.
I did notice that Director Malay addressed Director Kanich by her first name, but Director Stolzman.
I'd just like to take a moment to thank Brad, really, for all the work on this. We've been sitting here from MVIC, and now we're a different board, and you've been very patient with us, and I think the outcome is better than where we were when we started, and I appreciate all the hard work that you and your coworkers have put into this, and I think it really has come a long way. And at one point, you said you were waiting to take vacation until we got substantially into it. I hope you've gone back on that.
Well, I went to Sweden a month or so ago, so I've had my vacation, so now I'm back locked in. But thank you for that.
But I think if you had still been waiting, you definitely deserve the vacation now. This is a really big milestone.
And I'll have a beer vacation when I get home this evening. That's also a ritual. So,
I actually very much appreciate you making that comment, Director Stolzman. I think that that is absolutely true. We don't acknowledge staff's hard work often enough, probably. So, we are on to agenda item 7, and basically at our last work session, we asked staff to come up with some preamble language to kind of talk to what this document, when finalized, will be. So I'll turn it back over to Mr. Calvert.
So the chair did a good job of sort of setting this up. This is actually a conversation that probably has come up multiple times over the past year, but I think there was enough sort of momentum in the room last time to say, let's go, this is a perfect time to revisit sort of the intro piece of the plan, which really you haven't spent a whole lot of time talking about. In fact, you spent no time talking about. You really have sort of laser focused on what I would kind of call the policy elements. But I get that in some ways there was a struggle with that review, not having a really firm understanding of what this plan is and isn't. We've had that conversation multiple times in this room about vision versus regulatory versus aspirational versus something else. And so it came up last month, but there the introduction to the plan as written, the draft plan that's online and that you've received copies of, has some of that in there, but I you know, in looking at it, I realized it was sort of sitting kind of all over the place. And so really what we've done is we've taken kind of a few disparate pieces and try to stitch them together into a sort of a single introductory, I'm sort of using the word preamble, that sort of hopefully lays out what this plan is and how it relates to local planning and local aspirations and that sort of thing. I think the key note to sort of keep in mind is that a lot of the draft that the language we put together, which is obviously just to start the conversation, is really built on 6 key principles that have been adopted with at least the last 4 versions of MetroVision, some minor tweaks here and there, but it's been sort of the long-standing set of principles adopted by the board that really talks about, again, how this plan sets a regional vision, is aspirational, is long-term thinking, how it respects local plans. And so really what you have in front of you is hopefully just a chance to kind of consolidate all of that setup and into one place. And hopefully it feels like something that's close and you can have a conversation to get to a place that you feel like it reflects what this group's shared understanding of what MetroVision is. And I don't know if the objectives conversation was the hard conversation or if this is the hard conversation, but we're welcome to let you take a few shots at this and see if it feels like something that's getting closer to what you really were wanting to see as part of the document. And so the memo lays out kind of that longer preamble piece. And the one thing that I realized in doing this, that there was this slight omission in the draft, is that there's a standard disclaimer in the plan that talks about sort of the authority and why it's adopted, but the reason that hasn't showed up yet is because it always refers back to the adopting resolution, which obviously we don't have yet. So I went ahead and just threw that language in there, as it has traditionally appeared in adopted versions of the plan.
So I trust that everybody kind of remembers the conversation and the direction that we gave to staff to kind of put this together. So I'll open it up for discussion, and I've got Director Graves first and then Director Cernanek.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First, let me say, I think this is excellent. I think this is a really wonderful first cut, and I only have a couple of small recommendations. I won't
go word for word per Director Kanisha's recommendation, which I agree with, by the way. So two quick thoughts. In the first part where the Metro Vision Principles kicks off, I think you can actually strike that first sentence. I think it's really strong just to lead with, the region has a strong shared sense of its future, right? And then some of the other things that you're referring to or referenced in other sections. The second suggestion I have, very last paragraph in your draft here, Metro Vision fulfills the Denver Regional Council of Government's duty to make and adopt a regional plan for the physical development of the region's territory. The plan remains advisory for local jurisdictions unless their planning commission chooses to adopt it as their official advisory plan. I almost feel that could be moved up to the very beginning of the document because it really outlines pretty clearly why we're doing this. So those are my quick thoughts.
And I'll quickly add, don't get thrown off by the sequence. If you think about the final document, that disclaimer would actually probably come first anyway. So, but good catch.
Director Cernanek and then Director Millay.
Yes, and I'm going to echo some of at least what I heard as the sentiment from Director Graves. I think it's important to include in the preamble aspects that we've gotten to be a great region because there's been collaboration and hard thought, and there's been some guidance that has been taken from the documents that have predated this one, and to say we've gotten here because of that, and that we at least have some shared sense that as a region, not necessarily adhering to the letter within each, because we're not going to judge anyone on that front, but collectively, it's something that we have some thought, and there's been some level of participation in the development of this to take us forward to that aspirational aspect or that aspirational sense of the region to be even greater. And I kind of miss that, some of the path that has gotten us to be great, but then also what will take us to greater is what we're talking about here.
Director Millay.
I really appreciate this work, Brad, and I think it looks good. There's an element, though, that I think is missing, and in our dialogue at this table, we've acknowledged multiple times that we can't accomplish this by ourselves, and that in the first paragraph, you talk that the board recognizes implementation of the plan requires collective efforts, and I would like to see that expanded to say something like, of many partners, including local governments, NGOs, the business community. I mean, I think that is certainly what I was looking for in the preamble, is that we understand that Dr. Cog cannot achieve all of this by ourselves. So if you could spend some time, I don't have the exact words, but expanding that idea. I would like to hear thoughts of the.
And I'll say, so far from your comments and Director Cernanek's comments, I think that language actually appears elsewhere in some of the intro stuff. So far I haven't heard anything that would be, to use Jerry's term, rework or new work. I think it's just sort of maybe bolstering it a little bit and bringing it up front. So far so good.
And to me, it's important enough to be in the preamble, because a lot of the meetings that I was involved in with bodies that were not familiar with Dr. Cog, I think looked to Dr. Cog to solve a lot of the things that were happening that they didn't like in the region. And I think we need to acknowledge, we by ourselves don't have the power to do that as local governments. We do need the business community. We do need foundations. We do need faith-based community to work together to do some of these things.
I guess the only comment I would make is that it's one of those dangers when you start naming names and you forget somebody.
Well, and that's what I said. I'd let them come up with.
Director Jones.
Well, I was going to agree with a lot of the prior statements. I'll start with Director Millay's comments. That has been a continuous theme that we've wanted to highlight, in part because some of this doesn't make sense. When you say, well, Dr. Cog doesn't really work on that, and we keep saying, well, this is our regional vision where we partner with all sorts of people, and I think it will help galvanize them to action to partner with us on this. So I think it is useful to highlight that partnership piece, mm-hmm. and probably listing out some examples makes sense. I generally think this is great. And I'm embarrassed to say that the only substantive change that hasn't been mentioned is wordsmithing. which is at the bottom of the second page, traffic congestion, is sort of a negative narrow slice of the great transportation work that we work on. So I would just switch that out for transportation or transportation mobility, which enhances the positive things we do. So that's all I had.
Director Dyack.
The only thing I have to offer is this is becoming more of an assurance document. We're creating performance measures, and again, the performance measures look back to what we do as a region within each of our municipalities. We have different priorities of these outcomes, and you know, to me, it's more of an assurance document and creating accountability to determine the trends as to how we're doing as a region. And to me, I think that's important because I think we just have different ways of achieving this Metro Vision as a whole, but we do it in a very individual way. And you know, to me, I think that's very important to address.
Thank you. Other questions or comments? I'm not sure that there's anything really to take a sense of the room. It's just kind of making comments and allowing staff to evaluate those comments and make some changes in the preamble. And unless there's something else, Mr. Calvert?
I just sort of read the room. Do you feel like you need to see this again like this, or just when it comes back, as sort of a fuller part of the package with some discretion by staff to try to bring in these few points? Is that all right, or is this something you want to talk more about specifically at a work session?
Thumbs up on the latter.
Okay.
Yes. Very good. So it will not come back for further discussion at this point. All right. Agenda item 8 then, attachment E. And I will point out to Mr. Stiegel, just for information, that we have about 8 minutes left. Is this?
Yeah. That's my standard line.
So under attachment E.
I'll just make a comment.
Please.
That's food for thought primarily as we kind of move toward performance measure development. And I have an article I was going to hand out today, but it's not really that relevant yet, but I will. And it's just information that as we start moving in that to kind of get everybody on the same foundation of the philosophy around measurement, what we can expect, and I think, in fact, Director Beacom mentioned in the last board meeting about focus on continuous improvement and not perfection. So it's really some background stuff until we get there.
Director Jones.
So my question is, it's been almost a year, but MVIC, back when it existed, spent a lot of time delving into the foundational measures, wordsmithing them, tinkering with them, and then forwarding them to the board. And I'm just hoping that we start with that work already done, checking in on that, but that we don't start over on foundational measures, because we made our way through pretty much all of it. There are a couple of ones I think that we're still tinkering with, but. So I just want to confirm, what, maybe it's a question to Jennifer.
I think, and Brad actually may know the answer to this better than I do. I think part of this depends on what got changed in the outcome or the objectives associated with the measures in question. So I think that staff at least needs to take a look to see if things still flow. And if we think that we do, then I don't think that we'd necessarily bring them back for you to work on. But if we find some, if the measure just doesn't make sense anymore because of how the outcome or objective has gotten changed, then I think that you should take another look at those.
And I'll just add, we've done that. We've been tracking that throughout the process. And to Director Jones's point, MVIC recommended 8 foundational measures, including targets, to the board, and never actually made its way to the board for discussion. But as far as I'm concerned, when we pick up this conversation next month, that's the first thing that you're going to see. And there's, I don't know if it's affirmation or whatever, just a head nod. Yep, this is good work. We'll keep these. They still line up with the outcomes that you've talked about, the objectives. I do not want to feel like those 3.5 meetings were with not with purpose. So my intent is that that's something that we would just ask you to simply affirm and sort of begin the conversation from that point.
So in the queue, I have Kneach, Teal, Malay, and Jones. Director Kneach.
Very supportive of Director Jones and the staff plan. Show us if there's a discrepancy. If not, it's presumed to move forward. I had a little bit of a hard time following the memo in terms of what's actually happening next. So it gave me a good sense of the intentions, but I guess what I maybe at the next work session, you could just share with us. We anticipate spending one meeting reaffirming the foundational measures, of which there are eight. You know, we will spend, you know, we will share with you the 14, you know, whichever number of performance measures have, you know, we are confident in today. We'll tell you which we're going to keep working on and ask for your permission, right? I think if you could do it in a less of a memo format and maybe a timeline, it doesn't have to have dates, but even, I mean, just so that I can get a sense of how, I can't tell from this, is this one or two more meetings or is it six more meetings? I just would like a little bit of a, this talks a lot about what staff will do and then board will approve, but I don't have a sense of like what your flow actually is in a bulleted, numbered, or timeline format.
That makes sense.
Thanks. Sorry, it took a long time to get that out.
Well, I think Director Jones is exactly right. I mean, we don't want to reinvent the wheel. We don't want to lose work effort that had gone before. At the same token, I'd really like to back up our executive director in that we should keep an open mind in terms of the methodology that we've agreed to with the measure scorecard. You know, if we have a measure that is stranded, is redundant, is no longer relevant, you know, let's be honest with ourselves and let's give it the whack. Let's keep that open mind as we go through this process.
Director Malay.
And I guess that's where I am on this process as well. I think a lot of the reasons we stopped where we were and went backwards is because the buy-in on some of the the measures, targets, it just seemed like we were jumping in without a foundational base. I think we have that base now, and then the idea to say, I didn't go through all of this effort to then just go back to where we left off. I went through this effort so I could then have to look at those measures with a more informed eye. And I would argue that a lot of the people at this table weren't at this table when we were in the midst of those discussions. And God help me, I don't want to spend hours looking at this again, but I also don't want to just jump to a conclusion because that's and I don't think that's what anybody's suggesting, but I guess I'm not really, I do feel that there's an education that needs to go forward and that we're not gonna just jump to like, hey, here it is, here's our starting point. I wanna get buy-in to that. And I think that's what I'm hearing. I just wanted to say that out loud.
Director Jones. Nope. All right. Everybody good with the one caveat that Director Kneach pointed out of having an idea of a timeline of what this would look like? Obviously staff is somewhat restricted in creating that based on how we react and act. So, okay. Well, I will say then, any miscellaneous matters for consideration? Then at 5:57, we are adjourned. Thank you very much. Good job, everybody.
might be interesting.
What's that?
Well, actually, new job in Aurora.
Actually, I talked to Greg.
Yeah, I know someone
that.
Oh, really?
We have it.
Well, congratulations and happy Mother's Day.
Thank you.